Perfectly Awesome Fishing, where we try and give you the simplest, easiest and cheapest ways of catching fish. Now then, what about fishing with maggots? What about fishing with the float? What about mixed fishing? Not just carp, mixed fishing. Great fun, match rods, light tackle, you're going to enjoy it. Meanwhile, I'm editing yet another film. You guys enjoy it. Me, I've got to get my nose to the grindstone again.
So if you want to tear yourself away from the carp, all these other fish, you know where they're going to be? They're going to be really, really close in. And we're going to be using like match rods. And we can also do some floater fishing as well in case they come in close. But what we need first is to get those fish feeding is some ground bait. Some good old Totally Awesome ground bait. And we're going to be using regular bread, some of my favourite bran here. And what we're going to do is sop it up first and get it straight in the water like this. This is what I'm going to do. Get your bread, put it and just soak it in the water like this. Probably, it doesn't matter how wet this is going to get because we're going to be fishing literally underneath our rod tops. I'm just going to mush it all up like this. Get it all mushed up. You see it's really, really wet. But we're going to add to that some bran. And the bran is going to pad it out and it will get those small fish feeding. Normally I use a bran to help feed off the small fish. And this could work in our favour. Get yourself a good double handful of bran. Now you'll see immediately when I stir all that up, that starting to go nice and sloppy. And once that's soaking up, because you've got to allow it to soak a little bit, that's the thing. Now all this other stuff I've got is basically, it's just come out of my freezer. I'm having a freezer clear out, so every time I pack up fishing, if I've got some bait left over, I don't throw it in the water unless I'm coming back to fish. I'll put it in a cling film bag, whack it in the freezer so it freezes straight away, and I've got instant ground bait here. It's got sweet corn, got everything in it. We'll open this up one up in a minute. So I've got that straight out of the freezer. So anything left over, that's rare with me, but anything left over, freeze it down, use it again. Even down to lunch meat when I've been barbel fishing on the rivers. Just cling film around that, pull the cling film off. That meat, I'm not going to say I want to eat it and put it in a sandwich, but that meat is still good enough to use as hook bait. And certainly to cut up and put in there and get, you know, bream and roach feeding. I've even got some old here, frozen dog biscuits left over, some old frozen floaters. And you can see these, they're starting to break up mushy. So if they sink, no problem. If they float, even better. So we're going to be looking at, you know, sort of bream, small bream, roach, rudd, anything else that comes along. Almost everything but carp, but I'm sure sooner or later the carp are going to move in on this. I'm actually going to put some of these in the mix as well. So add all this in there. I'm going to split this one open. Look, it's a lovely lot of mix there. That is beautiful stuff. There's bits of worm frozen, maggots frozen, everything. It's all in there. And you know what it's cost me? I pay for it first time round, but I don't pay for it second time round. I've got it all to throw in the water just by freezing it down. Get all of that out. Give it a good old churn around there. I'll tell you what, we're late again. The Totally Awesome team are late filming. 2 o'clock in the afternoon, we roll up. Everybody's been in since about 6 or 7. Well, we've got no choice, it's the way it is. Let's start getting this in. And let me show you how close we're fishing. Oh, I think that was my car keys went in then. So all you're going to do, you're not going to be using, like I would do if I was barbel fishing on a river. I'm not going to be doing this with great big gobfuls of it. I'm going to be using golf ball sizes. Now it's all sloppy, it's all loose. And when I throw it in, I'm going to be going like there, like nowhere. And I'm going to try and bait it in about a 2 or 3 foot square. I want to keep it really tight. I don't like to bait up on a big area when I'm float fishing because I'm pretty sure here, it's a commercial fishery, that the fish know anglers come here and they know they're going to be fed sooner or later. And if the anglers are packed up, generally they just bang the bait out just down here, just like this, over the side, and the fish will come in close. So, going to bait up there, and I'll tell you what, I can't imagine it'll be very long before we have some fish moving in on that rod. I don't mind whacking quite a good bit in to start with as well. Get them feeding. There's enough fish in some of these lakes that are going to eat everything. Right, for hook baits, I'm going to be using 3 different types of maggots. Well, 4 if you count the colours. Just regular maggots here, which a lot of anglers don't seem to use anymore, but just regular red or white maggots. Now if I had a choice, on a river I'd use white, on a lake I'd use red. I don't know why, don't ask me that, make my brain hurt. But But that's what I tend to find, white on a river, red on a lake. But I'm also going to be using some pinkies, which they use a lot match fishing if the fish gets hard, which is a very, very small maggot. Very small maggot. But you can use these singly, and you, I'm hoping like the roach and the rudd will go on these. And then the pH de resistance are casters, which come in a bag, and these are deadly for chub. But also a lot of fish love eating these, because what they do when you eat them, I don't eat them, obviously I don't eat them, of course I don't eat them. When the fish eat them, they pop them. Oh, yucky. See, they go, throw them down the back of their throat, bosh. Instant juice, it's like soup in a case for fish, that is, casters. These generally will get the bigger fish, and maybe we might be able to pick off a bream or two with these. So we've got several bits of hook bait to try. Next thing we need to do, get tackled up and get fishing. Okay guys, now I'm going to be using this little chappie, which I think is a canal waggler. Obviously, being totally awesome, I'm using it in a lake, so I shouldn't be, but I think it's a canal waggler. Bottom end only, you can see the shot there, pinching it. And then what we've got to do, we've got to come right down to the end of the hook here, and we've got to plumb the depth, because you've got to make sure that you've got a bait on the bottom if you're fishing for bream. And to do that, we use one of these things called a plumb bob. Well, I call them a plumb bob, I've got no idea what they call them now. You put the hook through the ring, and then you put the point of it into the cork. That is obviously heavier than that little float, and it's going to pull the float underneath the water. I'll put this shot down here like this, and we'll put it in the water. Now, if it's too deep, you have to keep shallowing your float until you get the float just pipped up to about there. And even then, I like to leave a little bit extra so I know that bait's dragging on the bottom. Let's get it in the water and see if we can plumb the depth. Right, guys, you can see that float there has gone right under the water. So I'm going to shallow it up and try and set it again. I say shallow it, probably deepen it's a word. Up here higher. Move my shot up. Don't pinch your shot too hard, because when you slide it like that, you will fracture your line. Now let's just try again and see if that float is going to cock properly once it's on the bottom. Lower it down, lower it down. There's the... I can feel the... Oh, look at that. Look, there's the bottom. Now if I slack off, that is absolutely perfect. Look, there's the bottom. So what I'm going to do is come back out again, because I'd like to see if we can get, this is for Mike Swim, we're going to plumb Mike Swim here. He's going to use this canal float in a lake. Will it work? Now, that's where it was cocked there, right? But I want a little bit of 4 or 5 inches laying on the bottom. So if there's any drift, it pulls tight, it drags. It's not bumping along the lake bed. It's actually going to drag and sort of snag in a piece of mud or something like that. So I'm going to slide up about another 3 or 4 inches, take off. I now know I've got the right depth plus 4 inches. And I've got here another little shot. It's about a number 8 shot, just there. And that is, what, 4 inches from the five, say 6 inches from the hook. So that shot's going to be laying on the bottom. The hook's going to be here. And I'm hoping that we're going to get something like roach or bream. Who knows? Anything on the bottom. Okay, so we've got the float set up. There's the bait. I'm going to bait up with some of these regular maggots. Now these maggots come from the blue bottle, but I've also bought some pinkies, what are called pinkies. Now look at the difference in the size between those two. That's a sort of alien and predator. Look, he's going to attack him by the look of it. So this one comes from the blue bottle, the large one, and the small one there comes from the housefly, the small houseflies. These are good for big fish, these are good for smaller fish. I guess these will be better for the bream. I'm guessing these will probably be better if we want roach or rudd. But that gives you an idea, and this is how I'm going to hook them. Okay, what I'm going to do is, because they're barbless hooks, I turn them around to what they call the fat end. The head is actually at the thin end, people don't realise that. Roll it round and just nick very lightly onto this size 14 barbless wide gape hook, so I can get plenty of bait on there. I'm using a wide gape partridge hook, don't know if you can get them now, and I pop that one up over the eye, and that, I'll lay it down there, is the bait for float fishing. Now, answers on a postcard for anybody says, I can see the hook there. I don't think you can see it, and in a coloured water, I'm pretty sure the fish can't see that hook either. There's only one thing to do, add water.
When you bait up with maggots, once the fish find you, it can be action all the way. Okay, so not every fish is a monster, but you'll find the time passes quickly when your float sinks under every couple of minutes.
There we go. Right, guys, shows that the dog biscuits obviously work. Just in amongst the lilies on the edge. Nicely hooked as well. There we go, guys. Only a small one, in amongst the lilies. Good little scrap though, on the dog biscuit.
On small, commercial day ticket lakes, many anglers go home too early. A lot of the fish know that any time after about 3 o'clock in the afternoon will mean the dinner bell rings, as those same anglers invariably throw their leftover bait in the water.
Right, guys, we're on the treble maggot and tipped with sweet corn. A different sort of take with this one. Flew out of the water when it took, and it's a much better size bream.
That's a better bream, yeah.
Yeah, much better size. There we go. Better size bream this one, and they're notorious sometimes for leaping out of the water. When we were over in Old Berry Hill Lake, we had one, Dad had one that we lost that absolutely flew out the water. And even one this size, he took off. So quite notorious for flying out the water, these ones. And obviously they're slime. But good little sport on the match rods. Oh, let's get him back in the water.
Look for features like beds of lilies or reed-fringed islands. Both are hotspots for fishing.
Just in the margins down here where we've been baiting, and another small bream to tick off the list. There we go, there he's in. There we go. There we go, guys. Only a small one, but second one of the day. Let's get some more.
If you keep loose feeding those maggots, you should start to get the fish moving right by the bank edge.
Well, I've got one decent rudder here just to show you anyway, but they're a beautiful colour when you catch them. And he's on the surface there, but I've got it tight up against the lilies. There he is. Just look at the colours on those fins. That is why I like going fishing for rudd. But it's not the big one I was after, but it's still, what a beautiful fish. Look at those colours in it. Now you won't get that with a roach. You get a bit of a tinge of red, but nothing like that sort of blood red orange on the two fins there. And his pretty orange eye as well. I think I could be turning into an artist. Nice fish. And that shows you fishing with a float, not necessarily for carp, maggots, does work. You pick up lots and lots of little fish and different species as well. And that's really what fishing's all about.
Maggots were the mainstay bait of all freshwater anglers some 10 years ago, but they've been somewhat superseded by the marketing of various pellets. Okay, so pellets are convenient. You don't have to keep them in the fridge like maggots. But maggots are live, they wriggle, they basically drive fish crazy, and all species of fish eat them. As the saying goes, don't leave home without them. And one of the most satisfying ways of fishing them is with a float. There's nothing quite like watching it slide beneath the surface. A fast strike, and you're into another fish.
Okay, now what's happening is it's still dried off. So what I'm going to do, I've done this before, I'm just going to put a double handful of bran straight on the surface. Now it sort of breaks up the surface tension, and I'm hoping it will bring some of these rudd up.
So at least we can show it. But watch what happens when this goes on the surface. You can absolutely see it disperse out in a huge circle, spreads over a wide area, and that should bring up all the small fish. That'll attract the rudd, and hopefully I'll get them on the top where I can target them, perhaps with a piece of floating crust under the waggler. That's the idea. That's made a huge circle of bran there. Thousands of little particles, and when you put it in, I'll put another bit in there, that'll all disperse. You can see it on the surface film, absolutely expanding like crazy. And it just drifts out and helps attract everything. Well, we'll see what comes anyway. See if we get totally awesome lucky.
When you cast out, don't put your float right up against the lilies. If you do hook a good fish, it will probably go straight into them. Cast about 3 feet to the edge and then bait up the same spot. You need to draw those fish out from safety of those lily pads. Small fish to start with, but then the big boys will start to come out and they can eat anything. Well, almost.
Well, now I'm in trouble, guys, because I've been fishing for these rudd. I've had a couple of rudd off the surface looking for this big rudd, and I've put some bran out, just bran particles on the surface, trying to attract the rudd. But thankfully, I've gone up from the 3-pound hook length, I've gone to 6 pounds straight through. And wouldn't you just know it, little piece of crust, and up comes Mr. Carp on the waggler float. Got the bait right on the surface, about 3 rudd looked at it, and now the match rod is taken on a curve that it's not supposed to. But do you see me complaining? No. I am complaining. I've left the net up the bank again. I'm going to have to run for it. I'm going to leave the rod here. I've done it before.
Oh, hold it.
Go for it. Don't do this at home, guys. What I've done is I've been following these rudder shoal along. They're right tight up to the edge of the lilies. And I've scattered some bran in, like I showed you. It's dispersed, it's drifted up against the edge of the lilies. And it's pulling the rudder out, but unfortunately, or sort of fortunately, it's pulling the carp up as well. I don't really want the carp if I can help it, but there's rudd in there I've seen to at least, well, pound and a quarter. I think they're golden rudd as well. There we go, get him in the net. Now, if I could catch a rudd that big, I'd be really chuffed. But it's a carp. There we go. But I want to get back to the rudd. I can catch plenty of carp. They're at least a pound, and I just got that feeling they are golden rudd. Sorry, bud, you've got to get back. Oh, guys, this is the fish. This is the fish to see. Beautiful, beautiful fish. Let's hope. Why do they invent barbless hooks? So they fall off and give me a heart attack. Look at this one down there. Now, that is a nice, I think that might be a hybrid. Let's take it over in the mat, have a quick look at this one. Well, I'll tell you what, guys, is this a hybrid or what? That is a beauty. I think that is a big roach, but there's so many bream in here, I sort of wonder, is it a hybrid, is it a cross? I don't know. Maybe some of you experts out there can let us know. But it does look like an absolute beauty of a roach, and double webbed pinkies there, the little tiny maggots we mentioned earlier on. Look, absolutely tiny ones, put a little bunch of three on, and that is, I'll tell you what, we've not had a bad old afternoon's fishing. I think that's a roach, but there's a little bit in me that thinks that that taper there might be making a hybrid. But oh yes, pleased with that one. So it just shows you, get your maggots, get fishing close in with a float and a match rod, and get some totally awesome action. And what an evening. You know the saying, am I going home yet? No. Beauty. Okay, now casters are really the premier bait for the maggot fishermen. It's the final stages that they sort of pupate to before they turn back into a fly, a blue bottle or a house fly. So if you've got some maggots left over like this and they're starting to turn into casters, two things you can do. You can riddle them off by using one of these riddles that you buy from the tackle shop, tip them into there and it rests inside the box like that, shake them all around. It's like basically a sieve. All the maggots, the fresh maggots, will wriggle through into the bottom. Just move them around so they've all got holes. It takes just like minutes. You can do this while you're still fishing. Let them wriggle through like that, and you'll see, I'll take it underneath, they're gonna go all over the sling. There they are, there's the fresh maggots. And there on top, here on top are the casters. Now, when all those maggots have gone through, you've got casters, but you want sinking casters. They're the best ones. Unless you wanna go fishing on the surface for rudd, which in which case you want floaters. Well, you've got to discern which are which, and to do that you tip them. Now all those maggots have actually gone from there bar one or two. Tip them into the water, and if you watch this, I know because the sun's been out today, these are supposed to be sinking casters. Yeah, some are sinking, but hey, there's some floaters. So what you do is separate the two sinkers from the floaters. As you can see there, these are all the floaters. That means they've gone past the stage of pupation, they're getting ready to hatch into flies, but they're very, very good for using if you want to go rudd fishing on the surface or chub fishing on the surface. So all you do then is you just get them in the corner, skim all your floaters off there. You can either use them or you can freeze them down, and all your good casters are in the bottom here. There, these are all sinking casters, so they're still good. Those can either be used for sinking hook baits, or if you want to freeze them, you can freeze them down. Another tip from Totally Awesome Fishing.
Bream, roach, carp, tench, perch, rudd. They all love those little wriggly baits. And leave the heavy tackle at home. Get yourself a 13-foot match rod and a match reel. 6-pound mainline, 3-pound hook link if you want it, and get a couple of pints of maggots. If you want consistent action, this is the bait to use. And don't forget, maggots turn into casters, sinking and floating, so that gives you two more baits you can use. And the casters can be frozen down, and do you know what? I even freeze down my leftover ground bait maggots. Next time out, you don't have to spend so much on bait. Oh, that's a totally awesome saving. And if you get the small fish feeding, then sooner or later, a good carp or tench is going to shoulder its way into your swim. And that's when you get to see just how good your match rod really is. And all sizes of fish will eat them, from tiny roach and rudd right up to 30-pound carp. Where everyone else is still using those pellets, why not try something different? Use maggots. The fish will love you for it. And get that float in the water.
Here we go. Had the phone call from the wife. Look at this rudd, people. Oh, look at that one. Well, this one doesn't look so orangey. And hopefully we get to show you the difference between... Yeah, that one's a roach. Now, let's take the time to have a look at this one. That is a roach. It's not quite so deep this way. His jaw is underslung, not sticking out, not protruding at the bottom. And his two fins here aren't quite so red. Got a nice olive green to his back, whereas the rudd is sort of gold. And
very similar eyes. So a similar looking fish, but once you experience fishing, obviously you can tell them apart. But for youngsters, it's quite difficult. But hopefully from this, you'll be able to see the difference between rudd and roach. So that's carp, rudd, roach, perch and bream. We've been here 2 hours. Maggots? Yes, they do work.
Well, there you go, guys. Look, right down to another species. He's tiny, admittedly, but it is just about distinguishable as little perch, little baby perch. I can remember catching those as a kid, probably the first species that most of us caught as a youngster. And that, again, takes me back in years, but I'm still after a big rudd. Oh man, I'm trying to catch rudd and I just got slammed by it. It's got to be, well, it's not a rudd, that's for sure. I'm inches from disaster in the bushes. I got the rod bent absolutely double. So this is the downside of match fishing rods. I don't know if we're gonna get this fish. I need to get him out of those trees. He's up the bushes. It doesn't look good for me, ladies. This rod is not supposed to be doing this. And I'm absolutely maxed out with the rod. Can't pull any more. Tiny 14 hook. I've no idea. Big one, small one. I'm gonna have to move down here because I'm going around the bushes everywhere. I don't know if he's got me in weed or what. No, 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 I think we're clear. We might just have a chance at this fish. I just don't need him barreling over for those lilies or all those snags over there. There are plenty of snags on a size 14 hook and a match rod. It's me that's toast. Look at the bend in that match rod. It's not supposed to be doing this. You're not supposed to be doing... Well, if it snaps, it's my fault, but... I've got no choice, absolutely no choice. He is digging and digging. We've just done a little bit of scenics. And it's on the canal waggler float, and I'm pretty sure it's a bit bigger than a pound. Oh, I don't know whether it's going to last, guys. I don't know whether it's going to last. I can see the float, that's a sickener. I can see the canal float. Oh, I can't be any more. I just shallowed up to go rudd fishing, so the float is no deeper than 18 inches. Oh, yes, please. I've just seen a tail. The size of Godzilla. I think I need a fighting harness and a butt pad. Oh, it's rod. Oh no. Come on. I hooked that fish at 25 past five. And it's still no nearer the net. I thought first of it might be like a 3 pound carp, but he's bigger than three, that's for sure. Just unbelievable scrapper. There's our chance, there's our chance, there's our chance. Get him over. Get in, get in, get in, get in. Oh yes, he only just fits into the net. Oh, God. Oh, come fishing for small fish with Totally Awesome, and I'm supposed to be going home. Eat my shorts. Let's check this puppy out on the away net. And he's just hanging there with that tiny hook. Come on, come with me, people. Oh, look at that. And there's me saying, don't go carp fishing. And I just had a monumental battle with this carp just nicked in there in the scissors. He's gone right in the bone. Absolutely right in the bone. He had no pressure on anything. It's right in the hinge of the mouth on the barbless outlook. And just look at that. I would say he's about 8-9 pounds, something like that. What a scrap on that match rod. And it's definitely not a canal waggler carp, is it, that one? Were we lucky or were we lucky? What a beauty. Just check out the other side. What a beautiful scales this side. A nice big common carp. Look at that one. I'd be pleased to catch that one if I was just floater fishing.
Oh yeah, up you come. Nice big, and I'll tell you what I like, orange tail, always a sign of a strong, healthy fish. That fish took me, what, 20 something minutes to get in on a match rod? I'm not sure, want another one. Here we go, let's get the fish back. What an evening, what an evening. We're only supposed to come for a couple of hours. Here we go. Oh no, well the fish is gone. I think I've gone. Phone.
Hi. Yeah. No, it's been a bit slow, the fishing. Yeah, that's right, yeah. Yeah, no, I know we were supposed to be back. I realise that. Yes, Michael wanted to stay fishing, yes. Well, the fishing's been quite good. I've caught a few, Mike's caught a few. But he wants to stay late, Mike, so we might be, probably another hour. Okay. Love you.
Oh dear. Time to go, I think.
Well, guys, we're at the end of the day now. We've had the phone call from Mum. We've had the carp, we've had some pretty epic fishing, to be honest. And we've got a nice bream to finish off the day. I was on the phone actually uploading a picture to the group, as we do on our Facebook. And the rod nearly goes flying in the water, but luckily managed to grab hold of it. And we have a nice little bream. Biggest bream of the day, but a great take, flew out the water. Here we go, guys. Last fish of the day. I'm going to say last fish because otherwise I've got a hell of a lot of editing to do. But there we go. We finished on a good, about 4 or 5 bream. A nice rod. A great action on that carp on the match rod that Graham got. But I think it is definitely time to call it a day. What a beauty. Totally awesome.
And you can phone Mum.
Yeah. There we go. Let's get him back.
Well, I'm really in so deep now. With the wife, it doesn't make much difference. But what would you do? Would you go home and have tea, or would you stay catching specimens like this? It's a no-brainer, isn't it, really? Let's get it back. But I really, really got to pack up. Just one last cast, I promise.